Today's interview is with Alison Alvarez, the CEO and co-founder of BlastPoint. BlastPoint aims to make big data affordable and accessible to everyone through interactions with maps. Their software enables people to explore locations, discover new customers, evaluate expansion territories, and share those findings in seconds and without the need to be an expert. We asked Alison, what's your favorite book and why? Business and non-business if possible. She told us, for business, I would choose Getting to Yes by Roger Fisher and William Ury. This book changed how I think about negotiation. Instead of seeing it as an adversarial me versus them process that was all about winning, it made me think about getting what I really wanted in a way that would preserve and grow relationships. One of the most important pieces of advice was the need to understand your counterpart and what their needs are. When you have that in mind, there are often alternate paths to consider that would cost you little and would make everyone happy. There are so many non-business books that I love, so it's hard to choose. I guess I would have to pick The Hiding Place, an autobiography by Corrie ten Boom, about her experience helping Jews escape the Holocaust in Netherlands and her subsequent imprisonment. She has always been my role model for kindness, doing the right thing, and mental toughness. What I really took with me from the book were the descriptions of how she dealt with the stress of solitary confinement and eventually the Ravensbrück concentration camp. I adapted some of her techniques for keeping her mind occupied to deal with my own problems with anxiety and worry. Also, it's a book with a surprising amount of joy in it for subject matter that is so dark. We asked Alison if there was a moment specifically when something she read in a book helped her. She told us, I was not expecting to get this much as I did out of Evicted by Matthew Desmond. It follows several landlords and families in the Milwaukee area. The families depicted were struggling financially and living within a cycle of finding housing, getting evicted, and scrambling to a new place to live, often moving into homeless shelters when there was no alternative. The book is stark and an emotional gut punch in a lot of ways, but it revealed a perspective on housing that I'd been blind to. It also changed my thinking about how data can benefit communities. Evictions live in the public record, but are largely invisible in aggregate. Would people be more likely to recognize the problem if they could see it? I found the real value of the book to be in endnotes. The book itself is largely dispassionate, but if you look in the endnotes for each chapter, they reveal where the author was for all of the incidents in the book and shows how much he witnessed firsthand. I learned a lot about good ethnography, but also about how he established trust with the people he followed and got them to speak honestly about their situation. It was a good lesson for me because we spend a lot of time with customers, and getting them to share feedback honestly is a skill that leads directly to us being better. And sometimes that means investing time in people so they trust you with the truth. We asked Alison, what books had the biggest impact on you? She told us, I read the book Microserfs by Douglas Coupland when I was a teenager in the mid-90s. It's all about the early days of a small software company made of former Microsoft employees. It covers the development of their team, their quest to build a product, and their experiences living together and working together. The book is over 20 years old at this point, but the story itself is strikingly relevant. Prior to reading the book, I had never considered that a career in software development could be an option for me. My parents both grew up poor and chose career paths that would get them to a middle-class salary with the least amount of training. I lived on the outer edge of the suburbs in Georgia, and I don't think I'd met a single computer programmer prior to college. We had an old Packard Bell computer capable of running the original SimCity that eventually caught on fire around the time I read this book. Because of Microserfs, I asked for a laptop for my 16th birthday and was extremely shocked to get one. I fell in love with it immediately, took it everywhere with me even though it was as heavy as a brick. I didn't even have a way to connect it to the internet, but I used it for whatever I could, including programming. I don't think I would have picked up computer science as my major without the familiarity that I'd had with my own laptop and from the familiarity of the lifestyle outlined in Microserfs. We asked Alison, what books would you recommend to youngsters interested in your professional path and why? She told us, I don't think I can answer this question with specific books. Instead, I would recommend this. Develop a love for books and read lots of different kinds of things. History, literature, science. Flip through encyclopedias and dictionaries if you can. You never know what you'll find. Find your passion, but make sure that you read about the world outside of that topic. The reason I say this is that true innovation comes from connecting ideas from disparate places. I'm a tech CEO, so I've read lots of books on business and software, but I think our best ideas came from a spark of recognition connecting our products to something that was not immediately obvious. For example, connecting the dawn of epidemiology to mapping. I read The Ghost Map, a book about 1854 London cholera outbreak. The outbreak was stopped because of a map created by Dr. John Snow. You can see hints of his map in some of our customer discovery tools because it was such an effective way of pinpointing a solution to a seemingly insurmountable problem. Literature is also something I would highly recommend, especially for getting out of your own head. Good literature helps build empathy by letting you live through the eyes of others. Being able to identify with other people will help you build products that people actually want instead of just what you want. We asked Alison, how do you make time for reading? She told us, I am in love with the Carnegie Library's Overdrive ebook app. It provides access to thousands of ebooks and audiobooks instantly. I have 5 ebooks and 5 audiobooks checked out currently. If I'm really into a book, I manage to fit it into the corners of my day, reading to wake up and fall asleep. I'm currently reading a paperback version of SPQR by Mary Beard. Otherwise, I have learned to love audiobooks and use them while driving or while doing chores. Ebooks are my current favorite format. I have a fused spine, so I have to be careful about how much weight I carry. I used to always have a book in my bag, but now I have an iPad mini with a few hundred books loading into it, much lighter. We asked Alison if she takes notes or has any other technique for conquering the torrent of information, and she told us, I keep a research notebook and occasionally I'll write something down if it's extremely relevant. I also send quotes to my co-founder if they address a problem that we're struggling with. This is our most recent one. One always has time enough if one will apply it well. By Johann Goethe. We asked Alison how she chooses what books to read next, and she told us, I have a favorites list on Overdrive. I'm likely to choose something there. Occasionally, a book from my holds list finds me once it is available. We also asked Alison, do you prioritize the books recommended by certain people? Is there anyone that you consider a book recommendations guru? She told us, I have one friend who is unfailingly recommended books that I love. She is a high school English teacher. She recommended Kindred by Octavia Butler, which is just an amazing work of science fiction. I don't want to ruin it for anyone, but just trust me that it's a good read. Last question, what book are you currently reading and what are you expecting to gain from it? Alison replied, other than SPQR, I'm reading The People of Sparks by Jean Dupreau. I will admit that I'm not having a great time with this book and it's turning out to be a frustrating read. Sometimes there is something to be gained in things that are less than perfect, especially in thinking about what we could have done to make them better. Maybe this book will get better in the second half and I'll learn something about turning around a story? This was our interview with Alison Alvarez. If you want to find out more about her and her project, visit blastpoint.co. You can find all the books mentioned in this interview by clicking the link in the video description. TheCOLibrary.com is a daily updated library of book recommendations and interviews from the business people we look up to. Thank you!